Hey there, United States history students. Thanks for taking the time to watch this first of two recorded video lecture slideshows on the United States War in the Pacific during the Second World War. So in class, we've already learned about how the United States defeated the Nazis in North Africa and in Europe from 1942 to 1945. We've learned about how the United States defeated both the Empire of Japan and the Nazis during their efforts in the home front from that during that same time period. And now we're going to take a look at the United States military operations in the Pacific theater during the Second World War. This particular opening image that you're looking at here is the raising of the United States flag on Mount Suribachi at a pivotal moment during the Battle of Iwo Jima. And we'll talk about that when we get to the Battle of Iwo Jima. It's a great, very powerful image that was actually used to sell war bonds during the Second World War, and hopefully you remember what war bonds were and why they were important. Let's review what we know about what's happened in the Pacific that has gotten the United States of America involved in the war. The Empire of Japan, when it was expanding in the 1930s, becoming one of the most powerful countries in the world, invades China and commits terrible atrocities in places like Nanking. The United States responds by cutting off all trade, especially trade for oil. Then when World War II begins, Japan finds that it can begin taking over European colonies, especially the ones that are ruled by the French and the Dutch, and start taking the oil that's located there. So in 1941, Japan has its eyes on the Dutch East Indies, where there's a lot of oil down there. But the problem was the United States of America owned the Philippines as a territory, and they're not on favorable terms with us. And so they developed their surprise battle plan for how they can get the oil out of the Dutch East Indies and avoid having the Americans be a problem. And of course, that surprise attack is going to be on Pearl Harbor on December the 7th, 1941. The Japanese battle plan was to knock out the American ships in Pearl Harbor, incapacitate the United States Navy for 6 months with a Navy that was out, then the Japanese could invade the Philippines and take over the Philippines the following day, December the 8th, 1941. And by securing the Philippines, it pretty much opens up the corridor straight to the Dutch East Indies, which the Japanese do after that, and they begin collecting the oil out of the Dutch East Indies. The United States of America was expected not to be able to do much about this, but of course, we are involved in the war, and we are going to strike back at the Empire of Japan. And our strategy against the Empire of Japan in this particular theater of the war is what we're talking about in this lecture. So let me introduce you to this particular individual, Admiral Chester Nimitz. He's a very important person in this war because he is the head of the United States Navy. He is our head admiral during the United States Navy. In between the wars, Chester Nimitz had risen through the ranks by developing both submarines and aircraft carriers in between the First World War and the Second World War, two new forms of military technology that we developed prior to World War II. And of course, these two things play an important role during the Second World War. So after Pearl Harbor and after Doolittle's raid and after the capture of almost 80,000 Americans in the Philippines and General MacArthur fleeing to Australia by order of the President of the United States, we have our first major battle. And this is an incredibly important battle, and it's an amazing story of strategy both on the side of the Japanese and on the side of the United States of America. We're talking about the Battle of Midway, which took place in the summer of 1942. So the battle strategy for this is amazing. Well, first of all, look at this map right here. Midway is called Midway for an obvious reason. It's located almost in the dead center of the Pacific Ocean and between North America and Asia. So it's right in between Japan and the United States of America. Midway here is itself as an island or an atoll is blown up here. So its proportions are, of course, exaggerated. It is not this huge thing in the middle of the Pacific. It's but what we're looking at is where it is, where it's located. but it is part of the Hawaiian island chain. So just to the east of it, you see the Hawaiian Islands, the eight main Hawaiian Islands. But there are several other islands that are part of that island chain, and Midway is one of them. So the Japanese had planned on knocking out the United States Navy for 6 months, and they were successful at that with the attack on Pearl Harbor. We're still building up our Navy. So by the summer of 1942, they decide, well, we got to make a move here to completely keep the Americans out of the war. And the battle plan for the Battle of Midway was this strategy for how they were going to knock out the United States of America. So let's look at the Japanese plan. This is the plan of the head of the Japanese Navy, a man named Yamamoto. And here was his particular plan. They were going to send, the Japanese were going to send aircraft carriers and a fleet to the Aleutian Islands of Alaska. The idea was that the Americans would see the Japanese attacking Alaska and that we would flip out. The Japanese take Alaska, then it's not too hard to use Alaska as a base from which they can then attack the west coast of the United States of America. So Yamamoto would assume that the Americans would get scared. And we would send our navy out of Pearl Harbor. The few ships that we'd had, we'd go up to the Aleutian Islands and we'd fight the Japanese there to stop them from taking Alaska. Now, when we did this, then the next part of Yamamoto's plans called for simply making his right turn with these aircraft carriers and going after Midway. And there would be a second fleet that would show up with men to actually invade the island of Midway. Now, if you take Midway and you capture Midway, then you can use Midway as a base from which to launch the next attack on the Hawaiian Islands. And then the Japanese would take the Hawaiian Islands. After the Japanese took the Hawaiian Islands, then they could take the United States of America, or at least the West Coast of the United States of America. And if they do this, the Americans are out of the war. Japan wins the war in the Pacific. And what are we going to do about it? Nothing. So that was the plan of Yamamoto's. And honestly, Yamamoto's plan may in some ways may have gone through had we not broken the Japanese code. Now, we talked about this before when we talked about the war on the home front. What was very important for the Americans and the Japanese in the Pacific, where they're relying upon communication between boats, so this is going to be radio communication. Both the Japanese and the Americans have to come up with codes that cannot be deciphered. And of course, on the other side, we've got our cryptologists, our mathematicians, who are doing our best to listen in to the Japanese code and to break the Japanese code. And of course, we did it. Joe Rochefort was living in a basement in Pearl Harbor. He and his team of men are getting the Japanese codes and they're working on deciphering them, and they broke the Japanese code. So in the summer of 1942, the Japanese are planning on feigning an attack on Alaska and then taking over Midway, then Hawaii, then California. But we knew what the plan was. We figured it out. So Joe Rochefort did it. So Joe Rochefort, after he breaks the code, we've got the Japanese battle plans. So he gives them the Nimitz. Now it's Nimitz's job to figure out, like, well, okay, now that we know the battle plans, how do we then trap the Japanese? And what Nimitz decides to do is to launch an air attack. We're going to send our aircraft carriers out to intercept those aircraft carriers that are coming in. The Japanese had four aircraft carriers. We go out and we launch our dive bombers at the Japanese aircraft carriers, and we begin dive bombing them and taking them out before they can launch their planes at Midway. And we did it. Our dive bombers destroyed all four Japanese carriers. We win. We win. This is what makes the Battle of Midway so incredibly significant. It's not the Americans taking land back that the Japanese had already conquered. We will do that with the Battle of Guadalcanal. But we stopped a very important invasion that would have been an incredible victory for the Japanese and would have truly threatened the west coast of the United States of America. By stopping the Japanese at Midway, we are turning the tide of the war in the Pacific, and it's the summer of 1942. So let's take a moment and give credit where credit is due. Why does the United States of America win World War II? There's a lot of answers for this. There's the generals and the soldiers and our battle strategy and all of that. There's also wartime production. There's war rationing. There's scrap drives. There's the role that women play in the factories. But there's also the very important role of mathematicians. The Battle of Midway would not have been won had it not been for this cryptologist, this mathematical genius, Joe Rochefort. He's the one who broke the Japanese code. We don't break the Japanese code, we don't win the Battle of Midway. So let's tip our hats to Joe Rochefort, who really never got the recognition that he deserved during World War II. The Battle of Midway is an American victory. The next major American battle that I'm going to talk about is an extraordinarily famous battle, and a horrible battle, and a terrible battle, called the Battle of Guadalcanal. So let's take a look at where Guadalcanal is. It's this island that is in the South Pacific, and you see it circled there. The Japanese had taken Guadalcanal. This was at the extent of the Japanese Empire, as you see outlined on this particular map. On Guadalcanal, the Japanese had built an airstrip. And airstrips become very important in the entire War of the Pacific. From their airstrip, they can launch attacks on American shipping that's going in between the United States and Australia. And I'm not just talking about trade with shipping. It's war material and men. We are sending a lot of men to Australia in preparation for an attack on the Japanese Empire. So from Guadalcanal, the Japanese can harass us significantly. So the Battle of Guadalcanal is the attempt to take Guadalcanal away from the Japanese. If we're successful at this, then we will have finally captured an island that was previously held by the Japanese, and then we are turning the tide of this war to be in favor of the United States. All right, here's just another map of the Pacific. Guadalcanal located in the south there. Right, at Guadalcanal, there is a particular airstrip that's named Henderson Field by the Americans after an American soldier that had died previously in the war. And our goal then is to get onto Guadalcanal and to take this particular airstrip. When the United States invades Guadalcanal and we get into Guadalcanal, what we find is a swamp. It was swampy, it was hot. It was bug infested. It was nasty. A lot of guys got sick. But we begin the process of attempting to take the airfield. Now, here's just another picture of men walking through a swamp in Guadalcanal. What happened on Guadalcanal, though, was terrible. The Japanese were not going to let go of Guadalcanal, even as far away from Japan as it was, and as seemingly insignificant to their overall strategy as it was, they were not going to let go of Guadalcanal. So what they did was this. After the United States had landed its troops on Guadalcanal and had battleships circling Guadalcanal, the Japanese took out the battleships, thus kept trapping the men, the American soldiers, on Guadalcanal. When that happens, the Japanese get continually reinforced. So the Japanese are receiving reinforcements, their battleships are circling Guadalcanal, and the United States Marines who are on Guadalcanal are trapped. So the United States Marines have to head into the woods. They have to hide out. This is when the Marines become Marines. Some of them go on a starvation diet and they're eating nothing but bugs and whatever they can find if they run out of food. Sometimes the Americans and the Japanese engaged in hand-to-hand combat. Also, for the first time in the Battle of Guadalcanal, which stretches on for months, a half a year, the Americans realize the brutality of the Japanese. The Japanese were doing extraordinarily awful things to American men that they captured. The first thing they would do would be decapitate the men. They would cut off their heads. And then with their corpses, they would take the head and place it on the chest of the man, pull down the man's pants and cut off his genitalia, take the genitalia and shove it into the mouth of the man, leaving this mutilated American corpse for other American soldiers to see. When the American soldiers saw this, they were horrified, absolutely disgusted by the sheer senseless brutality and disgust, just the horribleness of this, of what the Japanese had done. Now, why are the Japanese doing this? Well, in part, it's because this is war, and war brings out the worst in human beings. But they're also doing this as a method of scaring the Americans. They want to be as brutal as possible with the Americans so that the Americans will lose their urge to fight the closer they get to Japan if they continue this battle. They are hoping to break the spirit of the Americans. The Battle of Guadalcanal is a long battle. It lasts for 6 months. The men who were on Guadalcanal dealt with horrible things. There were swamps that they dealt with, constant rain, malaria developed, everybody was constantly sick. The average soldier, American soldier, lost 25 pounds during the Battle of Guadalcanal. There was a United States Marine who went in August of 42. He was weighing 140 pounds when he went in. By the end of the battle in February of 43, he weighed 105 pounds. These men are sick and are still continuing to fight. It's worth mentioning culturally, during this battle, there was a movie that came out in the United States of America. And this movie was called Holiday Inn. And in this movie, there was a famous song recorded by Bing Crosby called White Christmas, which most of you are familiar with this song. It tells a story of, you know, dreaming of a white Christmas. This song was played over the radio to the troops in Guadalcanal, and it just broke their hearts. It did make them dream of home and of Christmas 1942 and what life was like at home. And here they are in a swamp listening to a song about a beautiful white Christmas. So let's just take a moment here and listen to a little bit of White Christmas by Bing Crosby. You can imagine how that resonated with the guys who are struggling in the swampy Guadalcanal. It took 6 months to secure Guadalcanal. A lot of this depended upon our Navy knocking out the Japanese Navy, resupplying our troops on Guadalcanal. But in the end, 19,000 Americans died. It was a horrible, long, difficult battle. The Japanese finally lost an island. We took an island from the Japanese, thus making Guadalcanal a significant turning point during World War II. But man, what a cost we had to pay to take Guadalcanal. And we are thousands of miles away from the home island of Japan. And we wonder, can we do it? Can we do it? How many more men are going to be lost before we can actually make it to Japan and force the Japanese into surrender? So what is our battle strategy going to be following the Battle of Guadalcanal? We develop a battle strategy, and the big battle strategy is called island hopping. And you can imagine, you know, if you are Chester Nimitz or if you are the Army General Douglas MacArthur, who are both out in the Pacific, you know, what do? How do we get our men from Australia up north to Japan, and how do we take Japan? What is our strategy? So these two men argued and debated about what to do. And essentially, they come up with this general idea called island hopping. So island hopping is this. There are thousands of islands in the Pacific, thousands of islands. Some of them are held by the Japanese. Most of them are not. Some of them are inhabited. Some of them are not inhabited. There are probably islands out there in 1943 that we don't even know about. But there's all these islands that are out there. And so what we decided we're going to do is some islands where the Japanese have major airstrips, we're going to take those. Other islands, we're just going to bypass them. And we're just going to save American lives by going around them and maybe setting up our own airstrips on particular islands. So island hopping, the ultimate design here is to get as close to Japan as fast as possible and save as many American lives as possible. So when there's an island that we got to take out, we're going to invade that island. But otherwise, we'll take over other islands and set up bases and our own airstrips, etc., that we can use as launching points for attack on Japan. So Chester Nimitz and Douglas MacArthur had, you know, two different ideas about what to do. So let's talk about Douglas MacArthur first there. Douglas MacArthur is down in Australia, and that's where we start off when he was asked to flee the Philippines on December, or in the early months of 1942. And of course, he left almost 80,000 men there in the Philippines. So he, you know, made this great promise, I shall return. And he desires to go right back at the Philippines, liberate the Philippines, and then from the Philippines launch an attack on the main island of Japan. That's what he wants to do. And then there's Chester Nimitz. And Chester Nimitz doesn't believe that's the right thing to do. The Philippines are huge, and there's a lot of Japanese there, and it's going to be a long, costly battle, he predicts, taking the Philippines from the Japanese. And Nimitz is right. It is going to be a long and costly battle to take the Philippines away from the Japanese. So Nimitz, who's the Admiral of the Marines, therefore, you know, he's the Admiral of the Navy, and the Marines are part of the Navy, so he's in charge of the Marines too. He doesn't want to go, you know, through the Dutch East Indies, take the Philippines, then from the Philippines go to Japan like MacArthur does for personal reasons. For Nimitz, he's like, no, let's hit the small islands out in the Pacific and then drive right at Japan. So in Nimitz's mind, if we're taking Japan, then they're not going to be able to supply the Philippines, and you know, we can hit Japan first, hit the mainland first, and then the Philippines will just sort of, you know, almost liberate themselves if we do that. Both of these men had to report to Franklin D. Roosevelt, and the president actually sat down and met with these men and discussed both of their battle plans and helped them coordinate sort of doing both at the exact same time. But what you see here in this particular image is the battle strategy of the United States of America. The army is going to go through the Dutch East Indies, go to the Philippines, liberate the Philippines. MacArthur wants to return to the Philippines, and then they're going to go after Japan. Meanwhile, the Marines and the Navy are going to be hitting some of the smaller islands out in the further east of where MacArthur is and with the United States Army. And I'm going to be spending most of our lecture time talking about what Nimitz is doing. So the next major battle I'm going to talk about is the Battle of Tarawa, which happens in November of 1943. With the Battle of Tarawa, the United States, this is going to be a battle that's going to be fought by the United States Marines. And the idea is to take this island where the Japanese have an airstrip and just hit it hard and fast with the United States Marines. We're going to take this island by sheer force. So this is exactly what we do. Tarawa is bombarded with artillery barrages coming from our battleships, and then 10,000 Marines invade. They do capture the island quickly, 4 days. They capture Tarawa in 4 days, but at an astronomical cost. We have almost 30% casualties. And 1,000 dead of the Marines. So it was a quick battle, but it was brutal, and there were a lot of casualties. Now, the amazing thing about the Battle of Tarawa was it was filmed. The United States Marines wanted the Americans at home to know what battle was like. They wanted to know that it wasn't all just heroism, that it was a painful, painful struggle. And some of the images, like the dead bodies you see on the shore there, the Americans had been protected from at home. This was such a costly and horrible war that it was just simply too painful to see those dead American bodies because you knew people who had died. Everybody knew somebody who had died. So the Marines wanted the Americans to know back home, here's what we're going through. And it was filmed. This particular film, a film was made out of this, a 20-minute long propaganda film, which Franklin D. Roosevelt himself watched. And he believed that the Americans should see this. So the film With the Marines of Tarawa, which is about a 20-minute long film, in color, it was presented before movies, in between newsreels and movies, as a form of American propaganda to get people to buy war bonds and to understand here's what war is really like and here's what our men are actually going through. So this is an incredibly powerful film, and it's amazing that it got shown at the time that it did. And honestly, it would not have gotten shown had President Franklin Roosevelt said, Americans need to see this movie. So With the Marines of Tarawa, which today you just Google it and you can watch it on YouTube. It's not that hard to find today. The next major battle I'm going to talk about is happening in the summer of 1944, and around the same time that D-Day is happening over in Europe. This is the Battle of Saipan. This is yet another island that we are going to take, and Saipan is important because, of course, it has an airstrip. And from Saipan, we're getting close enough to Japan that we can launch air attacks against the actual island of Japan. So here's an American super fortress, a B-29, which is an upgrade from the B-17s. Looks like it's landing here on Saipan. The Battle of Saipan is going to be unique in one particular way. There are Japanese civilians that live on Saipan. So when the Americans show up on Saipan, they know they're going to face Japanese civilians, and they don't really know what this is going to entail. But what they find out is how the Japanese civilians have been brainwashed. If you remember, the Japanese believed in the Bushido Code, death before dishonor. And the Japanese civilians had adapted this too. They were taught that Americans were brutal, awful creatures. They were monstrous. They had no humanity. And that when the Americans found you, they were going to brutalize the Japanese civilians. They had no respect for women or children. And some of the, or many of the civilians in Saipan believe this. And one of the most awful things that the Americans saw were Japanese civilians, mostly women, taking children and going to what the Americans dubbed the suicide cliffs and jumping off the cliffs with their children, killing themselves on the rocks below. So what I'm going to show you now is a brief clip here from the History Channel about the Battle of Saipan and what the Americans saw. Hi there, United States history students. So once upon a time, I had at this point in time in the lecture, film footage from the Battle of Saipan. That film footage was copyright protected, and I can now no longer have that in this particular part of the lecture. So I introduced this particular film footage, but I can now no longer show it to you. And furthermore, I can't find it online anymore, so I can't even provide you with a link for that like 2 to 3 minutes of film footage that I thought was really good and really meaningful. And I'm really sad that I can't put it in here, but gotta respect the copyright. So there it is. So we go back to the Battle of Saipan and my simple overview of it. All right. And of course, that is what the American commanders are trying to figure out. As we get closer and closer to Japan and closer to winning this war, will the Japanese ever surrender? Or are we going to have to fight in the streets of Tokyo, taking over the entire island? And at what cost will that be to the Americans? And we don't fully know what the commanders told our president, in especially 1944, 1945, as we get closer to Japan. But estimates range as high as 1 million American casualties in a full-out invasion of Japan. And so this starts influencing the American thinking, like, well, how are we going to take Japan and save American lives? Is it worth it to invade Japan? So there's one particular story from Saipan, which I learned when I was much younger, when I was studying the battle for the very first time as a student, which I've never been able to find a good picture for this. Some of the Japanese children were told to not be afraid of death. So when you see the Americans, these monsters, smile at them so they know you're not afraid of death. And so what happened was a lot of these Americans that are going to, you know, and the American soldiers are nervous too as they approach these civilians, because, you know, who are the civilians? Are they holding hand grenades? Are they going to pull some surprise attack themselves? And these children come out and they just start smiling at the Americans and actually disarmed the Americans as they embraced them and gave them food and started nursing them. So it was a bizarre thing that happened. And sadly, I've never been able to find a good photograph of it. But here are some Americans tending to some Japanese children on Saipan. Next battle I want to talk about is a battle which I never studied when I was a student myself. And because it's such a small place with a weird name. As I became a teacher and I started learning more about the Battle of Peleliu, personally, the more fascinated I became with it. It's a controversial battle. Some people say we didn't have to fight the Battle of Peleliu, and we could have saved thousands of American lives had we not invaded Peleliu. But Peleliu is so small, it's 5 square miles, and it's not even on this map. So I've put a little circle in general where it is located. So what I want you to look at here, before you look at Peleliu or where Peleliu might be, look at the Philippines. MacArthur is planning his invasion of the Philippines, and he looks at, you know, those islands, and he knows that there are Japanese with airstrips on those islands. And as he's planning his invasion of the Philippines, he's fearful that that invasion might get harassed by a few planes coming out of Peleliu. And so Douglas MacArthur tells Chester Nimitz to send the Marines to Peleliu and to knock out Peleliu. It's a small little island. Nimitz isn't fully on board with it, but he buys into the fact that, well, maybe it's not going to last that long. We'll send the Marines to Peleliu. They expect that the Japanese have a force of about 10,000 men on Peleliu. We're going to send ultimately the United States 1st Marine Division, followed up by the 81st Army Infantry. We're going to pour 45,000 men on Peleliu, and there's only 10,000 Japanese there. We're going to knock them out. It's going to take 4 days. But this battle was long and protracted, and the Japanese refused to give up. The Japanese are fighting to the death. And it ended up being a very costly battle. And what made the Battle of Peleliu very strange for the Marines is the terrain. Peleliu is this rocky, volcanic island, and there wasn't a whole lot of vegetation. It was very different from Guadalcanal. It wasn't a swamp. It was rocky, it was coarse, it was harsh, and so there was really no place to hide. It ended up being this terrible long battle. In the end, after 2 months of fighting, there were 11,000 American casualties, 2,300 deaths. It was a terrible, terrible battle, especially for the United States 1st Marines. It's about this time, as Americans are getting closer and closer to Japan, that Japan releases an incredibly terrible and destructive weapon. They're kamikaze pilots. So let's talk about what a kamikaze is and then who these individuals are. Kamikaze is a Japanese word that means divine wind. Way back in the 13th century, in the 1200s, the Mongolian Empire under Kublai Khan had attempted to invade Japan with these massive warships from the 13th century. But as they attempted to invade Japan, winds blew Kublai Khan's ships back into China. And Japan felt that it had been saved by the winds of God, the divine winds, the kamikaze. And so this myth is established that Japan will always be protected by a divine wind, a kamikaze. So when World War II happens and the Americans are getting closer and closer to Japan, once again, there is the belief that a kamikaze will save the home islands of Japan. But this time, they're not just going to rely exclusively on the power of weather and God, but on select individuals. Kamikaze pilots are pilots who are going to get into an airplane that's loaded down with gasoline and bombs, and they are going to go on a suicide mission, and they are going to fly their plane directly into American ships. This is going to be horrifying for the Americans who face them, because these planes are being driven by a human being. They're hard to shoot down out of the sky. And if they hit, the destruction is terrible. These planes are loaded down with fuel and with bombs, and they can take out a whole battleship. It was a very, very scary thing for the American soldiers that faced the kamikazes. If I can go back to this original kamikaze slide, it's interesting to think about who would want to be a kamikaze. You might think that, well, this is a suicide mission. You're just going to put anybody in one of these planes. And, you know, maybe people that you don't like or respect, you're going to make them fly the kamikaze missions. But what's interesting is in wartime, this became a very prestigious job. People signed up for it. The Japanese government had to turn people away from being kamikazes. And there's something in the mentality of, at wartime, the greatest thing you can do for your country is to die for your country, for the glory of your country. It was said that your soul as a kamikaze would leave your body upon death, and that you would remain, your soul would remain in a Shinto shrine in Japan, in the homeland. Okay. The next battle I want to talk about is the liberation of the Philippines. This is the Battle of Leyte Gulf. The Philippines, being this large island chain, the Leyte Gulf is in the middle of the Philippines. And of course, this is what Douglas MacArthur has been dreaming of ever since the Philippines were taken over by the Japanese and we had the Bataan Death March. So here comes the United States Army. They go, they take over the Philippines, and they initiate what's going to be a very, very, very long battle. This is going to last months. Here comes MacArthur, and this particular photograph that you see was staged. MacArthur shows up on shore 4 hours after the battle had begun and the beaches had been secured, so he would be safe to walk ashore. But here he is, marching triumphantly onto the beaches of the Philippines. He wanted the camera crews to be out there to take this picture, to send the pictures back home, so that it would be certain that MacArthur is fulfilling his promise of "I shall return" and the Philippines are being liberated. And they were. We go and we find the prisoners of war, who we see here are very, very, very ill-fed, and we are rescuing them. You see them drinking bottles of fluid. You know, if you have not had anything to eat and you've been starving, sadly, one of the things you can't do is eat food. You can't eat solid foods. So men were nursed to health by being fed broth for a long period of time. Here's another slide of individual men who were being liberated from the Philippines. And it is also important to know that it wasn't just soldiers that were held captive by the Japanese. The Philippines were American territories. There were families that were there. So here's a family that has gone on to become famous for talking about and writing about their experiences in the Philippines as Japanese POWs. This picture of the Weinheimer family was taken in 1945. They look pretty happy there because they've been liberated by the Americans and they've been nursed back to health. But there were children that were there. There were children there that were there that were starving. And children and adapting to the starvation and being POWs in a POW camp, they would play games. And one of their games was to see if you could touch your spine through your stomach. That's how ill-fed they were. They played games to see if they could touch their spine through their stomach. Here's Douglas MacArthur with the man that he left in charge when he was forced to leave. There's Joseph Wainwright, and we see how emaciated and sick Wainwright is. The Battle of the Philippines was a long battle. It's interesting to think about when we took the Philippines originally in 1898, when we invaded and took over the Philippines. You know, we took over the islands, you know, in a couple of hours when we knocked out the Spanish fleet in 1898. But this time, it's a long, protracted battle. What's interesting to think about with the Battle of the Philippines is the Japanese, when they took over the Philippines, some of the Philippines in the big cities, or some of the Filipinos in the big cities, like Manila, a lot of them just collaborated with the Japanese. They became friendly to the Japanese, and they helped the Japanese take over the island. In the rural areas in the north of the Philippines, there were communist guerrillas, communist freedom fighters, and they were attacking the Japanese, doing guerrilla warfare on the Japanese. In the southern islands and scattered throughout the Philippines, there were Americans who weren't captured. Some of these were American civilians, some of them were American soldiers, but they were not captured. And they joined Filipino guerrilla freedom fighters, who were part of this culture that had become guerrilla freedom fighters in fighting the Americans in 1898 to 1901. And so now the Americans had joined them. So there was American and communist guerrilla freedom fighters who were fighting the Japanese from 1942 all the way through 1945. This particular picture you see here is the Battle of Manila, which was brutal because it was house-to-house fighting, it was street fighting, it was building-to-building fighting, which meant there was just a lot of sniper fighting. You know, when you're going house-to-house-to-house, the battles are very, very contained in each individual structure. Battle of Iwo Jima, February of 1945, the exact same time that we are invading Germany. In Europe, we have this very iconic battle, Iwo Jima. Take a look at where it's located on the map. Please notice that we are well within striking distance of Japan. Iwo Jima, let's look at this particular image of Iwo Jima, this aerial photograph, which doesn't capture the whole island, but it captures some important prominent features of the island. First of all, in the foreground there, the southern tip, you are in this picture south looking north. And in the southern tip, you see Mount Sarabachi, this old volcano. And then the rest of Iwo Jima is flat as a pancake. So Iwo Jima is very, very flat with this pimple of an ancient volcano on the southern tip. Now look in the northern part of Iwo Jima. Do you see the airstrip? And of course, that's the airstrip that the Japanese had established. We want to capture that airstrip. We want to take it over and use it to launch attacks against the main islands of Japan. But this is an old island that was created by a volcano. And so let's look at this next image of Iwo Jima. And here we have American Marines today on Iwo Jima, where there's a base. Look at the sand that they're marching on. I think it was the 1960s, there was a movie made about this battle called The Sands of Iwo Jima. The sands of Iwo Jima are black. It's black sand. So It kind of the sands of Iwo Jima are also iconic. Okay, so I want to go back to this original picture right here and talk about the American battle plan. We know there's Japanese on this particular island. So the battle plan is this. Our battleships are going to go within striking distance of the island. There's going to be an artillery barrage. We're going to try to blow up as many Japanese fortifications that are there and kill as many Japanese as possible. And then we're going to put our men on shore and they're going to hit the sands of Iwo Jima. And then the first part of the battle is to take Mount Suribachi because we assume there's going to be guns on top of Mount Suribachi that can strike the Americans almost anywhere on the island. We've got to climb Mount Suribachi, take out those guns. Once we take Mount Suribachi, then we move on to phase two, which is taking the airfield. Now, when the Americans hit the shore, and here they are when they hit the shore of Iwo Jima, it's fairly relaxed. It's fairly relaxed. They go, they hit the shores of Iwo Jima. And for the most part, there's not much resistance. What the Japanese battle plan was on Iwo Jima was to play defense. They wanted to get the Americans on Iwo Jima, and then they wanted to take them out. What the Japanese had done was created these incredible fortifications throughout the island and in Mount Suribachi itself. And so, as the Americans approached Mount Suribachi, they would come across these pillboxes like you see here. So, as you're going up to this, it's really easy for a Japanese soldier to hide in there, to have their gun out, and to shoot the Americans as they approach. So, think about this. You're an American soldier and you're approaching this thing. You see this. You know what this is. There's Japanese in there that want to kill you. How do you kill them? You might take a hand grenade and try to throw a hand grenade in there to have the hand grenade explode and to kill them. And then flamethrowers. Flamethrowers were an important part of the American forces taking Iwo Jima. I've got this particular image here that you see on the left that the History Channel made of all of the fortifications that were built by the Japanese in Mount Suribachi. Mount Suribachi was essentially turned into a fort. If you look on the right side, you have an actual picture of the Americans approaching one of these holes into the tunnels that were dug by the Japanese. So this is going to be an important part of the battle of Iwo Jima. The Americans are going to have to go into those tunnels and clear them out. It was very scary stuff. But the Americans do capture Mount Suribachi, and it is atop Mount Suribachi where we have this iconic raising of the American flag. This is the Americans capturing Mount Suribachi. This is actually the second American flag that went up. The first American flag, there was one that was up, and then as that first American flag was going down and the second one was going up, photographers thought that this would be an important image to capture. And it was. It becomes one of the most iconic images in all of American history and especially of World War II. It's important to know that one of the men who's raising the flag is in fact a Native American who suffered severely from PTSD after the war. This image was used to sell war bonds to inspire people, especially in 1945. There's a lot of exhaustion from the war. Everybody's just knows people who have died, and so this image raised the hopes of the Americans, and it did inspire a few people to buy war bonds. And I finish off talking about this first part of the war in the Pacific by talking about two fairly recent American films. American filmmaker and actor Clint Eastwood, back in the early 2000s, made or produced two films. He thought it would be an interesting thing to make two movies about the same battle, told from two opposite perspectives. So, the Battle of Iwo Jima. There's two movies from around 2004, 5, 6, somewhere around there. And the first one is Flags of Our Fathers, which tells the story of the Battle of Iwo Jima from the American perspective. The Flags of Our Fathers, the movie, is based on a book written by a man named James Bradley, who found out that his dad was one of the men who raised the flag that you see there atop Mount Suribachi in Iwo Jima. And then Clint Eastwood was the producer, but not the but he didn't actually make the second film, Letters to Iwo Jima or Letters from Iwo Jima. He thought it was very important that the Japanese make this film. And so Letters from Iwo Jima is a Japanese film about Iwo Jima, the same battle told from the opposite perspective. So what was it like to be a Japanese soldier in one of those pillboxes, in one of those tunnels, and seeing the Americans pouring on shore and fighting to the death in Iwo Jima? So thank you very much for paying attention to part one of the Americans in the Pacific. We are within striking distance of Japan, but we know that the Japanese are willing to fight to the death, and how many Americans are going to have to die in order to win the war in the Pacific. That's what we'll learn about during part two. Hey, thanks for paying attention, U.S. history students. I'll see you in class.